today needs no introduction, but you'll get one anyway. Tom Belsdorf has trekked all the way from over in the department here at UCI. But of course, Tom is a regular here at our seminar. But normally he's down here. But this time today we have him up on the in the prestige spot, so that we can hear what he's been working on. Tom has many strings to his bow. Is that the right metaphor, I suppose? one for his work on like gay identity in Indonesia, perhaps very better known to people here for his work on virtual worlds, his ethnographic work in Second Life, and work he's done, and you know, writing he's done with Bonnie and Sui Pearson, T.L. Taylor on ethnography in virtual environments. And today he tells me he's going to talk both about past and future.
That's right.
Nothing but the present. There must be more present.
There'll be a little bit of present. There will be a lot of present too.
I give you Tom Belsdorf.
Thank you. Thanks. So thanks for having me and being here on a nice Friday afternoon. I completely changed the title because I get to do that, right? Because I have tenure, so I do whatever I want. So the reason why I'm calling it this is because this is another home for me, and it's been such a wonderful place for me during my whole now 15 years of Irvine to have this department and my colleagues here as an incredible source of support and collegial engagement throughout my career. And so what I'm going to do is sort of take you on a tour through Tom's brain in an hour or a little bit below, we will see here, and sort of doing links between anthropology and informatics in my own career, but also as an invitation for our two departments to continue to think about ways that we can keep working together in the future. So the bigger picture, of course, is thinking about interdisciplinarity in a broader sense, but I'm going to use my brain as the guinea pig for that. And part of that will be about ethnography, and as Paul mentioned, I did that book with Bonnie and T.L. and Celia Pearson on that. But anthropology is more than ethnography, right? And not all ethnographers are anthropologists. And anthropology is also about conceptual frameworks, forms of comparative analysis, theories of culture, that kind of stuff. And I'm going to try and actually front load a lot of that side of anthro just as a way to sort of stimulate the discussion of how we can continue to be working together and how I'll be working together with folks in the future. And so just as one example of that, and this is going to pop back in an interesting way about three-fourths of the way through this, is like a basic, like, I'm teaching intro to anthro to a bunch of 18-year-olds, and like, the first thing I try and teach them is, like, we have a folk model of how culture works that's quite dominant in the West, where you have sort of bounded cultures, there's Thai culture, there's Japanese culture, there's this culture, that's other culture, and then they have these sort of domains that they're made up of, and actually universities are often structured around this, so you have a department of art and music and whatever, but that this is empirically not how cultures work, it is wrong. The way cultures really work is that, first of all, they don't have clear external boundaries. They're stealing ideas and things from each other all the time. There's migration, there's globalization. But also, the really big thing to an anthropologist is that cultural domains intersect. And that in order to understand what's going on, you have to look at the intersection of domains. And often, cultures will actually have taboos, reading rules against doing exactly that. In many cultures, you're not supposed to ask, how is economics political? How is religion gendered? And so on. So there are often sort of reading rules against looking at these kinds of intersections. But this is the kind of stuff that gets anthropologists excited. And this is the kind of thing that's been the focus of work throughout my career. And so what I'm going to do is sort of tell you a story in four parts. First, I'm going to tell you about my first two books and my work in Indonesia and sort of plant some seeds about how the hell did I end up doing Second Life. And then I'm going to talk about some current work I'm doing, NSF-funded work on disability in virtual worlds, including showing a rough cut of a film that's about to come out on my research on that stuff. And then I'm going to talk about two things that are in process, one on the Intellivision video game system, a book I'm writing with Braxton Soderman, and then fourth, something that I have nothing yet published yet. I have one unpublished article about, which is this new artificial cultures project I'm going to be doing that I hope to be working with lots of you all into the future. So get ready for the grand tour. So the first part of the grand tour is my original work, which is in Indonesia. Here it is, between China and Australia. Fourth biggest country in the world by population, after China, India, the US, big place. And my research was mostly in Surabaya, which is in eastern Java, in Denpasar, which is in Bali, and in Makassar, which is a city of over 1 million people on the southern side of Sulawesi. And since I'm seeing this as like a collegial kind of friendly thing, you got to show the family slides, right? Mm-hmm. So here's Makassar during the time of some of my field work, working with gay and lesbian, transgender Indonesians. Here's one of the main groups that I worked with, Gaya Celibus. and if you see like these two folks right here, I'm the Nzul. You will see them here and here with me in 1993. Mm-hmm. So that's how long I've been working with these people. And I actually have an article about these, about this, what's coming out later this year on digital exclusionary populism. So I'm still actually doing work and publishing in this area, even though I've largely shifted to the Second Life work. And so during that work, I lived in the offices of that organization I just showed you. A lot of NGOs in Indonesia rent a small house for their work, and just worked for years. I speak fluent Indonesian, doing this detailed work with them, doing AIDS activism, but also work on queer sexuality. And you know, when in Rome, you gotta do what the Romans do. So I even, you know, dressed up as a beautiful Bhutanese princess. I look pretty good, don't I?
Yeah, thank you.
For an AIDS fundraiser. There's Bill, who has come with me several times to Indonesia. I have to move quickly before this ends up getting snapshotted on a web page somewhere. Move that. Actually, that picture's in an article I published, but not in full color. So what got me interested in this the problem, so to speak, is that since the 1970s, you see this rise of individuals calling themselves gay or lesbian around Indonesia, not linked to any one ethnic group like the Javanese or Bugis. They call themselves gay Indonesians. A big event, Liberty, is sort of like a People magazine there, and here you see in 1981, first time in Indonesia, a lesbian wedding attended by 120 guests. It was not an official wedding, but it was a very, that this is often seen as the moment when it first entered public consciousness there. But during the time of my fieldwork in the 90s in particular, there were no laws against homosexuality, nothing pro. Most people had no idea what the hell it was. so it's not the sort of medicalization story that you get in the West. So how did this happen? How are all these Muslims halfway around the world calling themselves gay, when most of them are lower class? They never met a Westerner who was gay or not, in most cases before me. They weren't traveling outside of Indonesia. None of those typical stories worked. So you do a lot of research, and then you eventually figure out, first of all, that media was incredibly important, that over and over again, people would tell me, I got the idea from a magazine, I got the idea from a TV show, but a full TV show about gay stuff would get censored, right? What they would get was like a character in Party of Five, or a gossip column about Melissa Etheridge. It was little fragmentary things, and there'd be this moment they would say where I knew that was me. But in terms of social theory, this doesn't fit the idea of how you get interpolated by a discourse, because it's so fragmentary, right? How could that be happening? And then to get even more interesting, media turns out to be really important to the history of Indonesian nationalism and the nation state. And so here's a picture from an image from a book from 1934, a nationalist novel, Behind the Veil of the Radio, Di Balik Tabir Gelombang Radio, where you see the guy, the main character, is dreaming of these two women. He's supposed to get married to this one, but he hears this woman's voice over the radio and falls in love with her, and much drama ensues. But media was incredibly important to all of these, you know, 3,700 inhabited islands coming together into a nation state to become independent from Dutch colonialism. And gay and lesbian folks also making their own magazines, going back to actually to 1982. And here's a cover I love from 1984 with the Indonesian national flag and the gay flag, right, next to each other. And as I started researching this history, I also found that in these early novels, for instance, becoming independent and becoming an independent nation was often linked to the move from arranged to chosen marriage, right? And the interesting thing about choice in marriage is that when marriage is arranged, sexual orientation is sort of secondary. But when it's about love and choice, that love and choice fails if it's not heterosexual. So sexual orientation comes into being as a new kind of social problem during this period, explicitly linked to the nation state and to national belonging. So during this time of my research in the mid-90s, there was a huge crisis that happened where, because Indonesia didn't make that much of its own media, they were mostly bringing in media from the US, Europe, a little from Japan and Latin America, telenovelas. And they'd either use subtitles or they would dub them, right, have local actors speak. And the government tried, and they failed, but they tried to ban all dubbing with the explicit explanation that if Indonesians hear Tom Cruise speaking Indonesian, they'll no longer know where Indonesia ends and the West begins. They will lose their sense of who they are as a nation. And that's sort of hilarious, but it made me very interested in, I always try and draw my theory from the field site, that's this Enid theory idea, is if you think about the theories of translation, they're haunted by their inevitable failure. You can never translate Shakespeare to French. It'll never quite work. But dubbing, you don't give a shit. Because dubbing, you're holding two things together that never fuse. The speaking mouth and the sound you hear of Tom Cruise speaking Japanese or Indonesian are never going to fuse. It's never going to perfectly fit, but you don't care. Because the goal is, can you figure out what's going on and can you get by, if you see what I'm saying. Dubbing has a very different kind of epistemology to it than translation. And it made me think about, when I was doing all these interviews with these lesbian and gay Indonesians, their experience of being gay or lesbian Indonesian was sort of like dubbing. It didn't quite fit, but you sort of make it work. But it never quite seemed to work. And so I developed this idea of dubbing culture to think about a theory of globalization that doesn't have a teleology that ends in unification. Deeply informed by media. And during this time now, we're just starting to get the internet coming in 97, 98, actually even 95 a little bit. And I got very interested by how this archipelago concept in Indonesia of the nation made up of all these groups like islands is actually shaping the way that people would talk about being gay or lesbian as like an island in their life. I don't have time to go entirely into it, but that's one reason, for instance, why it was quite cognitively easy for gay men in Indonesia to marry women. Because the idea that you would come out to your parents or that you would have to be out in these kind of nested circles didn't make sense to them, because when you got the idea of being gay from a gossip column about Melissa Etheridge, the whole Foucauldian story coming from Freud and confession and the metaphor of coming out of the closet, none of that came along at this point, right? Very, very fractured. So I would have my interlocutors doing reverse ethnography with me asking, why do you want to come out of work? Like, do you get a raise? Like, why do you care, right? Why do you want to be out to your parents? Like, why do that to them? It doesn't make any sense, right? So it really helped me think about sort of new forms of selfhood, the way that difference doesn't just correlate with how far away you are. Things can sort of skip. So a gay Indonesian might think they're more like a Westerner than a straight Indonesian near to them. All these kinds of interesting things. And a big punchline, because of this role of national discourse, being gay or lesbian in some ways was the greatest success story of the New Order state at that time, that was trying so hard to get Indonesians to not identify as Javanese or Balinese, but as national Indonesians. Because it was striking how people do not identify as gay Balinese or gay Javanese. All the slangs, for instance, also based on the national language. So take all of this, and I know this is just going to be drinking from a fire hose, so just get used to it. Put yourself in this spinning space as much as you can. And this interesting role of media and technology. And now watch this with Indonesia in your head. Two swimming pool scenes. The second scene is a little bit traumatic, but the person wanted this in the film and actually directed the scene. We could talk about it.
Integrating or condescending or assumptive or anything. They really wish they could fix my situation. My name in Second Life is Shaila the Super Gecko. Not even in. right or wrong. And sometimes they're so wrong, you can't take it back. You know, when I first came to Second Life, when I began to spread out a little bit, I'm getting to realize that the mother is disabled people here, and I don't know if this is a game. It certainly is sustenance to be able to come here and be in a place where there's only a hurricane, or not a hurricane, even the hurricane takes me out. Yes, get up and start walking again.
Hey there, I'm Draxter, also known as Bernard Drax in the physical realm. Before we let the story of our digital selves unfold, here's a few clarifications. This documentary is based on a 3-year study led by Tom Burstow and Donna Davis, supported by a grant from the National Science Foundation. My role in all this was fly on the wall with big sensitive ears. You will see me popping in as my avatar embodiment here is, asking follow-up questions and getting additional context. Generally speaking, I tried to stay in the background as much as I could, leave the field to our protagonists and researchers. So without any further ado, let's dive right in. Enjoy. Take it away, Tom.
My name is Tom Elstorf. With my colleague Donna Davis, we've been focusing specifically on the experiences of people with disabilities in Second Life. And so
basically, we framed this research project was to look at disability experience in Second Life with a real interest in the body and embodiment, but not limited to that.
Disabilities and abilities come in lots of different sizes, shapes, and flavors. The people in our community, they don't like to think of themselves as disabled. They think of themselves as ability diverse.
What we look like is the way people treat us. And we find that so many of the people in our community have created avatars that are the symbolism of who they are.
One thing that makes Second Life interesting for research is that it's a case where you have a lot of control over what your avatar looks like. If you're playing a military game like Call of Duty, you can't appear as an elf. You can't appear as a Klingon, right? There's limits. You might be able to change your camouflage or your gender, but not much more. Second Life is one of those virtual worlds where you can change it as often as you want. You can change it every hour if you felt like it. And you can change everything from clothes to your entire embodiment. You can be a refrigerator if you want to. And so that has really interesting implications for embodiment, because that's really different than a physical embodiment.
A key lesson around virtual worlds is that embodiment is always in placement. This is one reason why for our research project, we really wanted to have these islands, because we wanted it to be about the relationship between that and place.
And in my experience, in some ways, avatars come second, because without a place, you can't have an avatar either. I mean, the avatar has to be in a place, or it's not an avatar, it's a screenshot.
Now,
6 months. Anything about her?
And, you know, the classic agency of taking care of something because others
told her. There's a little for a please.
Oh, I'm just going to go like this so I can get to that. One minute. Like, and one of the people is going to be quite difficult to understand. I can understand him, so I'll speak it, and then... but not the first person. You're just going
to
hear two narratives.
When we are trying to go over a traumatic experience, or just like the memory of it, she asks me that, what would you do to your childhood self help her suffer less? That's my homework. I sometimes look into Second Life. I can pick who is around her. I can pick where she is. And I can see that she is safe.
Here we go.
We have somebody in our community. She has 6 babies in Second Life. She is the first to say, I know people think this is weird. But you know what? It gives me joy.
My mother's turned 92, and she just found out because my sister with dementia told her. Did you know that she's on this gang and she's married to a white man and she's got 6 babies and my mother? And I feel bad. but I could not have babies. So when I was able to have babies and sacrifice, I just really thought that was something.
It's not about me creating a baby. It's about creating a sense of care. And people who have babies like that are perfectly clear about that distinction.
I have a total of 7 children. The oldest is Bobby, then 2 sets of twins, Ella and Emma, Axel and Alicia, then there's Cassandra, and our newest baby is Devin Jr.
The pleasure in caregiving and to have that kind of reciprocity, even if it's in a small way, that agency of taking care of something because others are taking care of them so much. And many of them are parents or caregivers for elderly parents.
I can do whatever I want. Hey guys, I have an idea. Why don't you come over and hang at my house? I've got a pool and everything.
That's a great idea, Brody. That's cool.
caregiver to Paramount Studios to show this clip and talk about it with some of their folks who are doing work in virtual reality and virtual worlds. So as you can see, there's an interesting link to my earlier work in all kinds of ways, including things around place. And it's a little hard to see here because it's dim, but we gave participants in the study land, free land to build on, and this is what Lady built, the woman who you saw talking about having the kids because she can't have them in the physical world. And she built a structure with like five stories on it, and each story differs in how opaque it is. So this is almost clear, and this gets more and more opaque, and there's a chair in each. And so she moves up and down depending on her anxiety level because she has PTSD and some other neurological conditions. And so it actually is a way not just to symbolize, but to actually deal with and experience and show what it's like to have these kinds of different layers of anxiety and how it help and how she relates to the outer world with that. And so in terms of basic points, like I did with the culture thing, a basic point that I'm going to do until like my last breath in this work is that this idea that the digital and the real are sort of on a line is also empirically deeply wrong. And instead, we have Tom's digital reality matrix that I recently published, where they're skewed, right? Where things online can be real or not, and things offline can be real or not. Because this thing scares me, not just because you assume that online things aren't real, but also that everything physical is real, like there's no Halloween, or there's no, you know, Shakespeare, once again, something like that. So the degree to which something is real or not is independent of the degree to which it's online or not, depending also on what your definition of reality is, which becomes a very interesting issue I look at in this research and elsewhere. And so some themes that come out in this, I'm going to just do this quickly because I mentioned a lot of it in the film as well, but one thing is, at the risk of pointing out the obvious, not everything in the physical world here is media. Like I actually, because my dear husband Bill loves paper media, we actually get the New York Times every morning, like in paper in the LA Times, and that's wonderful. But this chair is not media. The New York Times paper I hold is. This is not media unless you have such a general idea of the media that everything is media and then it's not interesting and useful. So not everything offline is media, but not everything online is media either. And one issue that we face in the study of technology is the conflation of going online with media, right? Not all mediation is media, once again, unless you're using a really, really broad view of media. And in disability studies, which is one of the communities I engage with, research communities, this is important because the vast majority of work on disability is about blogs, websites, it's about media, online media, but that is not all there is online. And particularly thinking about embodiment and place is an area where you need to think about things online that are not just media, that are different than media. And one place that I think anthropology can be of help, not just around ethnography, once again, is thinking about how we don't just study the new and the big. You would not believe how many people ask me, I didn't even realize Second Life was around anymore. Are you still studying it? No one has ever asked me, why are you still studying Indonesia? Is it still around? There's such an obsession, Silicon Valley hype-fueled obsession with the new and big. It's like if anthropologists only studied China and India, right? Those anthropologists that have made their name studying a group of 500 people, right? That the significant is not the same thing as the scalable, the big. And this, you know, Second Life is 500,000 industry anthropologists, is big. You know, to Zuckerberg, it's not. But we can learn really interesting things about it that can actually help us think about things like Facebook. And so this project is something that I've been doing with my colleague Donna Davis. And in terms of method, this idea of participant building, not just participant observation, what happens when you give people a place to build, and then not only interview them about it, but watch them as they engage with the space, has been a really interesting thing to look at. And also because, once again, when people talk about disability online, it's often about mobility, and that is a big issue. A lot of these folks can't drive, that kind of thing. But it's not just mobility, and it's not just about compensation. So even in a story like Ladies, where she can't have kids, she's having kids in Second Life or whatever, it's not just about there's a hole in the ground and I'm filling in the hole. New possibilities came into being for Lady through the stuff she's done in Second Life. It's not just compensation for a lack. That is a very ineffective and inadequate conceptual framework to explain what disabled folks are doing in virtual worlds. And in terms of that role of place, here's my avatar, really tiny. We actually had to make this giant curtain on the island. Because because we have some people with epilepsy, and people were making really brightly colored builds that with like moving images that were triggering seizures. So we actually had to make a curtain for some people who wanted those kinds of builds to sort of accommodate everyone. And it was the debate around this was really, really interesting. I don't have time, because I want to talk a little bit about my two other projects, but just to give you another quick piece of something. This is in a forthcoming article I'm working on around disability of virtual worlds. Interface became a really interesting issue. So there's a bunch of viewers you can use to get to Second Life. It's like using Firefox or Chrome or Safari to go online, right? There's an official Second Life viewer. The most popular one is called Firestorm. There's one that's less well known called Radagast, but it renders the world into text only if you want, which is great for blind folks because then they can use a screen reader to see what's happening. And you know, one person when we were talking about, like, why would blind people want to go into virtual worlds? They're so graphics intense. And the response was, look, the physical world is so graphics intense too. deal with that. We love going online. And so, like, as an interesting, one interesting issue this raises is the way Luna Lab created the world, the viewer, when you make objects, unless you name it on purpose, they all get called objects. Unlike Microsoft Word or something that forces you to save something with a name, it'd be like everything being named document, unless you take the time and trouble to rename it, which most people don't do. And so blind folks go in using Radagast, and they don't know what's a chair and what's a floor, because everything's called object. Right? Like a really interesting interface issue that starts to come out. So here, and I'll tell you the important parts, so you don't have to read it all, but here's a really interesting case of a blind person, who I will call Molly, who has two avatars in Second Life, and this interview was with both of her avatars, I'll call them Diamond and Ruby. Once again, in terms of research ethics, you anonymize avatar names, not just physical world names, right? So Diamond, one of the avatars, is saying, hey, Ruby is my main avatar, and I used to move her from Radagast into Firestorm. Because dancing is hard in Radagast, it doesn't work so well with animations. But one day I tried that, my avatar was all messed up, it became a cloud, no one could figure out why. And we eventually realized, she did, there were these sort of fundamental code problems, that if she wanted to be able to speak, she'd have to create another avatar that would live in Radagast, only in Radagast ever. And that Ruby, my new avatar, her new avatar, could never set foot in Firestorm. So she had to have two different avatars. So she created Diamond, this new one, to be her voice using the Firestorm viewer. And then Ruby using the Radagast viewer, and she using two computers, logs them into Second Life at the same time. So one speaks and the other navigates. And note how she's talking about these viewers, about living in them. They're almost turning into places. Right? They're almost turning into places. And then she says, and at first, this new avatar that was my voice was like playing with paper dolls. She was just there to talk for my main avatar because I had to use Radagast for Ruby. But then something happened. I know this is going to sound silly, but she became her own person. She took on her own personality. And now I think of her as somewhere between a staff member, a maid, and a baby sister for Ruby. So here's an interesting case of multiple embodiment that's not about all of those news stories about, you know, someone who's transgender, someone who has a personality disorder, whatever they want to claim. Here's a case where the interface shaped embodiment in a sense of selfhood. Really interesting, once again, like I use a kind of dubbing framework to think about this. Can you see the sort of conceptual links that I would make with this? Here's another case. Hazel is very severely autistic. And one way that it shows up, she can't work in the physical world. And one way this shows up in her physical world life is that she has to have clear lines of sight. She has to be able to see doors. If objects are stacked, they have to be from low to high. She has a lot of very specific things about how she deals with the physical environment. Guess what happens when we look at online environments? So I'm sitting with her, I didn't have time to put up a picture, next to this volcano on this one island in Second Life, and she says, I love this place. It's an example of my line of sight need. I can see all around, nothing can creep up. In that way, my interface is very safe for me. And she always uses the chat window. You can break out chat into its own window, in its own box, with a black background, boxes and boundaries, very important to me. So she's carrying this in and transforming it into her Second Life space. And she actually said at one point, I'm not as comfortable with Discord as I am with Second Life. Discord isn't the place. The geography is lost. There's no view, no perspective. Notice how like they themselves are seeing these interesting distinctions that the internet is not a unitary If I can't see safely, I start to feel panicky. So safety, sight works for me for the text and the space. I need this line of sight to breathe and feel safe. Just another interesting example of how place is shaping all my embodiment and subjectivity, but not in the typical ways about the way you look, right? There's so much focus on the avatar look. This is about sort of the pure experience of being in a place, the pure experience of being in a place. And that's why, like, in my theorization of this work, I actually turn to phenomenology, right? So here's Merleau-Ponty talking about the body is not a thing of objective space, but a system of possible actions, a virtual body with its phenomenological place to find my task and situation. Like, the dude wrote this, like, in the 40s, right? It's awesome. My body is wherever there's something to be done. And so I'm engaging both with sort of work on ideas of, like, the life world and dwelling that comes from phenomenology, but also work that comes from, like, Rosemary Garland Thompson and Tobin Siebers and disability studies on complex embodiment and the question of misfit between body and place. And this is what I'm developing, if you know what being in the world is for Heidegger. You know, I talk about being in world as a playing around with that, to think about what are the stakes of that, and what might it mean to think about a kind of topography, not a geography, but a topos, a topography, of disability, but of experience more broadly. Because just like with my work on gay, lesbian, Indonesians, part of the interest here is that disabled folks teach us about the human experience more broadly. Queer folks teach us about the human experience more broadly. They also teach us about sexuality. These folks show us interesting things about disability, but what they're experiencing is part of the human condition. And for able-bodied folks as well, there's really interesting implications here. So now I'm gonna talk about my two future things for like 7 minutes, and then we can eat and chat or whatever. So this is a book that I hope to have written by Semmer with Braxton. We both have fall quarter off, we're gonna do this thing. Intelligent Visions. So this is an anthropological project, but it's not ethnographic. It's a study of the Intellivision video game system from the 1980s that we both grew up playing. We have one article that's come out in Games and Culture on this already. It was actually very influential, and this notion of intelligent visions is actually giving me an alternative genealogy to thinking about AI. It was the first video game system to have its own operating system inside of it. It really pushed this idea of intelligence compared to that dumb Atari. So it had like a controller that was explicitly playing off of the new phones that were available at that time, with overlays that could get very complicated. The Running Man, it was the first video game to have a kind of human figure that could articulate. So much interesting stuff about it. And the article we first published, just to give you once again, how does an anthropologist think about this stuff, was really focusing on the rivalry, this will be a chapter of the book, of the rivalry between Intellivision and Atari. And you know, here, the first issue of TV Gamer, we deal with the two most popular systems of today, Atari and Intellivision. Like, it's amazing how much play Atari gets, and people forget how Intellivision was actually seen as the big competitor too. It was one of the first big sort of tech competitions that was happening, right, between about 1979 and 1983, with some stuff afterward and some stuff forward. So, putting on my anthropologist hat, I have a gentle critique of Ian Bogost and other folks in platform studies that were using this rivalry thing to get at. So the platform studies model, and this comes right out of Ian's work, looks like a computer stack model, if you know what that is. And so you have platform code, all this kind of stuff. And then it's surrounded by culture and context, right? So anthropologist Tom looks at this, and the first thing he thinks about is this model of culture that I was saying is actually wrong. That cultures have discrete boundaries and have sort of domains in them that are discrete as well. This looks a lot like that, right? It's that same model of what culture is. And look, this is from Altice's book on Nintendo that was published in that platform study series. A platform is a holistic network of objects and texts, including cartridges, controllers, peripherals, marketing materials, play environments, and emulators. Now, here's E.B. Tyler's 1871 definition of culture. A complex whole, which includes knowledge, belief, art, morals, law, and custom. Can you see the parallel there? Now, this idea of discrete cultures that are their own context arose in the 19th century as a response to evolutionary theories of culture that were ranking some people over others, and were taking objects out of their context, right? And looking at like fish hooks and who has the best fish hook, and they're the most advanced. The Samoans were better than the Tahitians or whatever. And this response, which began as early as Tyler and went through Franz Boas's work, was based on the idea that, for instance, you can't can't understand a flute without understanding the orchestra, right? You can't understand things outside of their context. You need to understand their context. But what we've known since like the 1930s is that while the evolutionary view was a problem for understanding culture, this is an inadequate response to that problem for many reasons, including the assumption of being discrete. And by looking at the rivalry between Intellivision and Atari, we're trying to look at how what happens if you think about that rivalry as ontologically prior, because it turns out a lot of design decisions around Intellivision were shaped by Atari and vice versa. And it helps you understand things like the rise of third party. The first third party game companies, Activision and Imagic, were born out of this rivalry action. And so it gives us a better way, we're going to claim this trans-platform concept, to think about platforms in a way that doesn't partake in this assumption of discrete domains that, once again, coming from anthropology, we've known for a long time is an inadequate way to understand how a culture works. And I know this is hard, and you know, I went into depth, and so I struggle with this too. And in our article, we actually try and fail on purpose to come up with alternative diagrams. It's hard, right? I mean, there's so many other out there. So like, here's two that I try, just like playing around on my computer. Like, what might be some other ways of thinking about culture and domains of culture that preserve intersectionality and forms of interchange, but yet let us think about the stability of platforms, because platforms do have stability over time that we need to take seriously. There's a reason why we can plug in a television and play it today. That is consequential. So we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater, right? Okay, final thing, because this is something that hopefully in the next few years I'll be doing with some of you, is my artificial cultures project. And once again, I think hopefully you'll have fun thinking, what are these crazy links in Tom's brain through all these projects? But this is how it is for all of us as scholars, I think, as we, you know, many of you are doing your dissertations, doing that kind of thing, and then as you move on in life, you get to sort of stack these things in a fun way. So the fundamental question that's orienting me around this now, sort of like when I did the Indonesia work going back almost 30 years, the 25 years, was like, how are people halfway around the world calling themselves gay? Is AI is going to transform what culture means. As we move into the future, there's going to be fewer and fewer cases where we are hanging out and there's not some AI in the mix in some way, shape, or form. So human sociality is going to be human AI sociality moving forward more and more. Not 100% of the time, and there'll be some AI socialities that have no humans in them. But the mix is going to become more and more common. How are we going to study that? How can we build on the history of work in HCI to study that? Because there's a great body of work already thinking about some of these things. What will happen when artificial intelligences become ethnographic objects of study? What happens when they become ethnographers in some cases, right? And are participating in the research. So as an anthropologist, I'm trying to move beyond the sort of individualizing implications of the AI metaphor, which sort of assumes little brains and things, and to think about artificial cultures. To think about that as the ontologically prior object, and how do we think about human and AI implications in those cases. And that would include sort of context of cultural mediation, so digital media, things like chatbots. Things like cultures of digital place, so non-player characters in video games, even ladies' babies are an early example of that kind of thing. And then digital entities in physical places, whether that be Alexas or watches or probably my molar at some point, you know, not too far in the future, or whatever that might be, but also cars, you know, autonomous vehicles, things like that. What will happen as we move forward? And in terms of building off of prior work, this will not only include sort of the work that's out there on human-computer interaction. In the draft article I've written on this, I become really fascinated with the long history of work on multi-species ethnography that goes back to Lewis Henry Morgan's work on the American beaver in 1868. And you know, Tim Ingold, who many of you know his work, you know, has a wonderful quote: "There's never been a time when all sorts of non-humans have not been enrolled in the task of keeping life going. What's changed is the nature of the non-humans." Right? The human has always been a multi-species project, whether that's domesticated animals or the macrobiome. We have always been a multi-species project, and so we can do this. There's ways in which this builds off of long existing questions about the relationship between human and non-human social actors in the cultural situation. And in terms of methodological stuff, one thing that I've been really thinking about is how this doesn't mean that you necessarily have to be a programmer, right? Because you situation where the people involved aren't programmers themselves either. And a parallel sort of in regular old anthropology is you can be fluent in a language but not necessarily know its grammar, right? Being a linguist and speaking a language are two different things, right? Or being a neurobiologist and being able to talk to someone while their neurons are firing is not the same thing. So there's a lot of great potential here for collaborative team work, right? But there can be that kind of distribution of labor. Because my real interest is in the insider emic experience of what sociality with AIs is going to be looking at. And methodologically, another thing I've been thinking about is the norm that we have in anthropology that you need to do a year of field work really comes from observing the agricultural cycle. It's actually remarkably hard to figure out who originally talked about it. It seems to be W.H.R. Rivers. But that are there ways to do shorter fieldwork projects to get at some of these things that don't turn it into ethnography light, which is not ethnography, rapid ethnography, which is not ethnography, ethnographically inspired, which is not ethnography. But what is the Goldilocks space for that, and what kinds of research questions might that open? So hopefully through this crazy wild tour of Tom's brain, past, present, and future, you see some interesting shared themes. Here's the old wonderful Far Side cartoon of the anthropologist coming off the tropical island and the natives grabbing their, back then it was VCRs and TVs, saying, anthropologists, right? But of course, the grain of truth in that is the idea that traditionally anthropologists weren't interested in technology. The whole point was to study people without it. We've come a long way, I hope, since then, to think about how technology is actually what makes us human. Techne is what makes us human, not something that's external to it. And that there's all kinds of powerful ways that anthropology and informatics and allied disciplines can work together. And what I hope anthropology can bring to the table is ethnographic methods, but also some of these conceptual frameworks. And so my little made-up term of anthromatics, I think we have a lot of great futures for working together, and I look forward to doing that. Thank you.
As usual, our primary space of discussion will be downstairs over wine and drinks and things. But we can take a couple of minutes for some questions first. For anyone who wants to ask them here, you just can't wait before you get answered.
Sure. I have two. I just don't always be the first. So I'll make sure someone else has a chance to raise their hand. So I have two questions. I'll only ask one, I'll ask them another. One's legal, one's existential. Which would you like to be asked?
Oh, existential. Are you kidding me?
Okay. So, through my schooling, through my learning, through different things that I've come to see, I've been wanting to call the digital real. There's really no difference between me perceiving that space and organizing myself in it and coming to figure out who I am in that space as opposed to the real world. And so when you kind of say that we're making these artificial boundaries between what's physical and what's digital, and it's not quite appropriate. There are places where bodies are doing these places, and that's what matters most. Can we also then think of that perspective and apply it to the individual as well and see not just the boundary of the skin is what makes us who we are, but also being able to leave this body and the things that I do, the words that I say, the art that I make, those are all very important in the conception of what it means for me to be a human. And so not just to say that this is my human self and this is all that matters, but like this phone is as equally part of me as I am human. It's part of my body, and really trying to recognize that in society and what that means going forward, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, Gregory Bateson, another famous anthropologist from the mid-century, has a wonderful quote about, consider the blind man with the stick. When does the arm end of the stick begin?
Right.
It's what's engaging with the environment. And so that sort of prosthetic experience of being is not limited to the online, absolutely. And the real, it's once again, not everything online is real. It's just some of it is. Like if I learn German online, I can go to Berlin and talk to people, right? And so it's just getting more nuanced in thinking about it rather than that assumption. Because in my experience as an anthropologist, even if people in the world very quickly say IRL, real life, hey, I'm gonna get back to real life. If you ask them, oh, so what do you mean by that? They absolutely think of what's online as real. Like you can't just take a colloquial thing of I have to get back to real life as indicative of how someone's really thinking. And so these are really interesting questions that we can't leave our human bodies as easily or change them, but those things are really powerful that way. And one way that my disabled folks have really challenged me theoretically in a very interesting way is I had it beaten into me through graduate school and beyond
that the mind-body thing is bad, it's stupid, Descartes was wrong, it all smooths together, how, you know, this sort of Cartesian division between mind and body is complete bullshit, whatever, that kind of thing. And over again, I had disabled folks pushing back and saying, if you say that I am my body, I'm screwed. This body is in chronic pain in a way that you hopefully will never experience, Tom. I am not my body. There is a distinction, and I need that distinction, and it is a real distinction for me. And that folks with a range of disability, Cody will often talk that way as well. That I'm not my body. He's not stupid. He experiences his embodiment constantly, right? He has to help. Someone has to, Sessie has to help him go to the bathroom. He can't do almost anything on his own, right? That caregiving dynamics are important, but he's more than his body. And there's an interesting way in which taking that seriously helps me think about avatar embodiment in a new way.
Thank you. I have two questions also, but I'm going to just choose one.
Is one that's essential?
Well, it's the same question, actually. but maybe just put differently. But when you were talking, I kept thinking about, you said at one point, you said quite, thanks for the talk also. Obviously, it's kind of like that, going a lot of different directions at once. So at the risk of complicating the talk, or maybe just like adding another concept to what is already quite full, I just was thinking about what you said, that, oh, these are ways to learn different varieties of human experience. You said something about, in that earlier talk, and then I saw that you kind of had that thread throughout all these pieces, that there was some, I think, quite generous way of looking at human existence. But it did seem to me also that you were relying a lot on the category of the human, which in other contexts has become quite problematized lately. So I guess I want to ask you the same question, just be like, well, can the work that you've shown us today sit comfortably with post-humanism?
So two very good questions. So first of all, in my first book, The Gay Archipelago, I have a whole section called Toward an Anthropology of Similitude. Because in anthropology, historically, difference has been what we look for, and we know we made it when we found it. And in so much scholarship in the social sciences and humanities, difference is self-evident, it is authentic, it's what we're looking for, we've hit it. Sameness or similitude is contamination, it's inauthentic, it's suspect, it's domination. And I actually am just as interested in similitude as I am in difference. In fact, you can't really think about one without the other, right? And so I am very interested in sort of relationships of similitude and difference between all of these projects. So even back to the Indonesia work, what I was pushing against then was that either a claim that we're all global queer brothers and sisters, that we share a gay gene or something like that, or that Indonesians who call themselves gay are victims of false consciousness and victims of global gay imperialism and, are deluding themselves and trying to find, another path for that. The human thing is something that's really interesting, like anthropology means the human, right? And so for me, the way I think about it is as a kind of human is a multi-species project to open up the category of the human that way. But I actually take a pretty strong stance against the post-human. I'm a suspect of most posts. I think there's usually more posturing than content in most posts. Post-coloniality not as bad, and post-structuralism not as bad if it's used right. But I'm very suspicious of them. But also, especially given my own disciplinary history and given this current project that you saw the film clip from, anthropology has an unsavory history of talking about some people as human and not, right? And it goes back to the polygenetic debates of the 19th century. And disabled folks are constantly struggling with not being seen as fully human. And so I don't like the term post-human for those reasons. But another reason I don't like it is like my Far Side cartoon, is that when people talk about things like Second Life in terms of post-human, I don't like that because there's an assumption there that when you add technology to the human, it makes it post, rather than it being technology is actually integral to the human experience and always has been. It's not external to human being. Instead, it's about that diversity of human being. So the danger that I find with post-human is that it ends up reifying a very narrow notion of what human is, in addition to those, in my opinion, political and ethical problems with the concept of the post-human. So I'm not saying it can never be used in an interesting way, but I find it to be used in a quite problematic way in most times, most cases, usually as a kind of hype thing, like, oh my God, I'm so rad, post-human kind of thing. And I just don't find it to be empirically correct in that sense. So, the danger then in doing that is being trapped in a sort of limited notion of the human. But that's why for me, like the multi-species artificial culture stuff is another case where I'm really trying to open up that category of the human, but working within the category. So I am, but that's something I'm still
wrestling with, and this new project will be a totally fun way to really dive into that exact question, because I think it's really important in this day and age. Super important.
Okay, well,